Okay, for you to establish TCP/IP setting, as in TCP/IP session, is always a three-way handshake, like synchronization, acknowledgement, and acknowledgement before the data will begin start sharing. I thought about that before. Now, there is a security you can actually implement in your local network if you configure your ACL to only allow established traffic. Now, what I mean by established traffic or established TCP session is that nobody, if, okay, let me take it down. If C1 wants to communicate with web server, it is C1 that will initiate the traffic. So when C1 sends traffic to web server, web server will not respond. So for web server to respond, it was actually H1 that established the session. So it is a security breach for someone outside, like from internet, to have access to your network without someone being inside to establish it. So it's a way of securing your network using ACL to ensure that it can only allow established traffic from your local network. And the configuration is, as you can see on the screen. If you look at now, you are configuring router one. And what you configure is to be out. Like we are configuring here, this interface. That's the interface to be out. And what do we configure as out? We permitted TCP to be established. So it's only this port can only allow established TCP link. Like now, if this guy acts off server, it can only allow established traffic to pass. But it will never allow a traffic that was not established from inside. It will never allow this. So it's a way of securing your network. So it's going to allow only established traffic, TCP established traffic. And you're going to allow echo reply, like someone can stay here and ping. Now, when you ping, you are sending echo request. So when you send echo request, like for instance, you can see, I don't know whether you can see my screen, my, can you see my
Yes, I can see it. I can see
command
it.
prompt? Okay. If
Command
I see
prompts, yes.
ping www.yahoo.com, I press it, I send echo. So this is reply. Echo reply that came from Yahoo. So if things like this happens, I'm just allowing echo reply because I'm sending, if I ping, I'm sending echo. So echo reply, it should allow echo reply. And also if I ping, if it's not reachable, it's going to come as unreachable. So I'm going to allow only echo reply and unreachable. So from this configuration, nobody can ping you. Nobody can ping your network. That's what it means. And nobody will have access to your network from outside. So it's a very good security approach when you are configuring your ACL. When you use ACL to configure a security.
I've had this experience in the past.
Okay.
I wanted to reach a particular network
Okay.
from a host. It was not communication. There was communication, but I was wondering why I could not ping that particular network. And when I asked, I will not be able to ping, but that communication is established. So I was wondering how what actually happened.
Okay, this is what people used to configure when they don't want to, maybe don't want to think about so many things to configure, with so many security things to put in place. If you put this kind of thing in your router, it's much more applies a lot of security to your network. It means that nothing outside will come in. except from inside. People cannot do other things too. So it's very important. This command helps Herod in terms of security. I'm not of that. So that's for that. Then remaining, I don't know what I thought about this too. You know, when we configured BTY configuration.
Sorry, sir. Please let me get that page before you move.
Where is it? This.
Okay,
so BTY. Okay, let me take you back to something we did before. Basic network configuration. Okay, I want to take you back small to something. I think it's supposed to be this. Okay. You know, before we configure VTY, that is virtual terminal connection. This is it, VTY 0 to 4 or 15, whatever. You put password, login, either local login or ordinary login. So now this is just, you are putting password. So that if someone log in or telnet to your router or network device, it will demand for password. As if for a visual terminal connectivity. Now you can actually do more too. You can configure more security on it. As I will still talk about radios, how to use radios server on it. Now, the same VTY, look at it. You can put password, whatever thing, but there's a command you can also add, which is access class 3N. What we actually did there was that. In it, you are trying to allow only one system to be able to have access to the virtual terminal connection. Or have access to the virtual terminal, better that way. And that system must be only this. So we now said access list 3 permit host this. And we now get to line VTY, that is interface. We now say access class 3, that is a 3. The same ID number. We now made it inbound. So it's only, it can only allow inbound of this system to have access to it through virtual terminal. So even if you know the password, even if you know the password and use another system to connect, it will still not open. Why? It's because it was configured to allow only one system. So it's a must that you have to go to this system to configure your router. As an IT person, you can't go to any other system to configure, even if you know the login details and everything. So this is another command you can use to secure your virtual terminal. So you can actually secure a virtual terminal using ACL to allow only one specific IP address to have access to it. So that's that for that. Also, just want to cross check to be sure that I treated everything I'm supposed to have treated before we continue. I said under these apps. Okay, this one I've thought about inbound and outbound. Okay. Coming to NAT, this is where I talked about before. I said NAT is network address translation. Mr. Mano, you're welcome. Network address translation is, as I explained the other time, that It's all about translating private IP addresses to public IP address. It helps you to secure your network. Like for instance, this is a router. The access it has to internet is the public IP address, which is this. So anytime someone like this wants to have access to internet, it will fill up the frame. Of course, you understand that. Can I still bring up that frame again? Fill up this frame. Sorry. No, don't this frame a minute to check something else. Okay. Sorry, I'm coming. So for someone to send a message, the person will fill up the frame. This is destination IP address, source IP address. So when they fill it up, when it gets to the router, router will not change the source IP address to this. Maybe this guy is the person sending message. Of course, he's going to fill up the source as this, possibly. But this is source. So when this frame gets to the router, router will now change that source. Like if it's this guy, it will change the source IP address to its own public IP address and send. The same thing with this, if you send, router will change it to public IP address. So, and when router sends it, when this guy is responding, maybe the server back, server will now still respond to this IP address because you received from that IP address. So when it gets there, router knows that anything that comes to this IP address belongs to this guy. So that is the network address translation. And I said they are of two types. We have static NAT and dynamic NAT. Static NAT and dynamic NAT. And I say static NAT is actually used to assign a permanent IP address to a particular local address that external users can use to access onto it. For instance, if I have a server in my network, Google servers, Yahoo server, or a server that is that hosts files for people, or hosts web for people, or hosts domain for people. For someone to have access to that server, the person needs IP address, the public IP address. Like server, like Google, I think that Google is the IP address of their server is 4.4.4.4.4. Something like that. Now, them, they will not give that to their server like that. So the server itself will not have this IP address because it will be on a local network. It will be on a local network. So on the local network, you still need to give it its own local IP address. It has to have a local IP address. So, but for someone to have access to it, the person will need a public IP address. So what you need to do on the router is that you give it this configuration on it, on the router. You're telling the router that any IP address, this is a public IP address, of course you know that. So this is what you must have bought from the internet or something. That's a public IP address. You know, Of course, you know our public IP address is for sale. So if you want someone to have access to your network or to your device or to your server or to your system, you need to buy IP, public IP address. But local IP addresses are not for sale. So possibly this is the local IP address I gave to that server. But this particular one is the public IP address. So what I give router now is that any IP address coming from internet going to this should be channeled to this owner of this IP address. So this is what you are supposed to give to your server, but you configure this on your router so that as soon as router gets any IP address on this, it will send it to your local server. And that can be likened to just as what I just showed you here. If someone is browsing this web server, this is what the person is browsing, but actually this server will not be giving this IP address. It will be giving a local address. So if someone browses, as soon as his router sees this IP address as the destination, it will know that it belongs to this server. So in that case, that is the way to configure static NAT. So that's that for static NAT. So you just ensure that you are assigned host to internal transfer to the same register. Okay. So that's that for static NAT. Coming to dynamic NAT. Dynamic NAT, if I come to dynamic NAT, I still need to give you an overview of dynamic NAT, the way it works. You know that I can buy 4 public IP addresses here as my external. So that if someone here wants to have access to internet, hold on, please. So if someone, so like for instance, this person wants to browse, as soon as he gets to the router now use one of the public IP addresses and send. If this guy wants to browse, router will use the remaining 4, one of them, and send. Like that. So if someone responding to the 5th IP address, router know it belongs to this guy. If response is coming to the 4th IP address, rather not, it belongs to this guy. So possibly, public IP address could be, public IP address could possibly be 1.1.1.1. The other one can be 1.1.1.2. Another one can be 1.1.1.3. Another one can be 1.1.1.4. Another one can be 1.1.1.5. For instance, so this guy, when he send the router, not translated to this and send. So any response coming to this IP address, router know that it belongs to this guy. If this guy is sending, router can use this. So any response to this IP address, router know it belongs to this. So that is the way dynamic NAT works. Now the question now is, how do you configure dynamic NAT? To configure dynamic NAT is what we have here right now, but I'm going to explain it. Okay, just a few moments. Okay, sorry about that. So how do you configure dynamic NAT? Dynamic NAT, first, you need to You need to create, these are the three things you can do when you're configuring Dynamic NAT. First, you need to create your access list for your internal network. Like for instance, there's a possibility that my network is, let me, where can I get network now? Can I see use this? Okay. If this is my internal local network. So in it, here, I am permitting the whole network. This is my internal network, for instance. I'm using one to permit it as my list one. So all your local network, you use your SEL first to list them out. Then you now create a pool, public address pool, for your public address. Just create a pool for your public IP address by saying IP NAT pool, any pool name of your choice. You can call this one, this is optional. Just give any name of your choice. Then this is the range or the pool of your public IP address. So it ranges from 131, 132, 133, 134, 145, till 140. Of course, this is the net mask of it. So after you must have done the two, the next thing is going to be, you are linking this pool to this access list by saying IP NAT inside source list one. You see that I used one here. Then the pool name, see the pool here. So that is how to configure your Dynamic NAT. Of course, the interfaces, this is your local interface. Of course, you do the inside, NAT inside, outside. That is your where you have your public IP address. You still do IP NAT outside and all of that. So these are the major commands. Of course, you deal with your interface. I've talked about this one before. Or you can still say under this line, under the third line, you can actually do, you can actually say, instead of saying list one for this, you can replace it with. Okay. Is that instead of saying IP NAT inside source list one, pool, the pool name, you can just say IP NAT inside source list one, interface serial 0/0/0. That is this interface. This can be likened to be this. Maybe this is interface here. Whatever thing that is the name of this interface. Of course, no, that's where the public public addresses reside. So is that you are saying IP NAT inside source is one, pull the pool name, or you say IP NAT inside source list one interface. You specify the outside, the interface of the outside NAT, which is this. So that is the way to configure Dynamic NAT. If you have any questions, I will need to continue into parts. Please, I'm waiting for your question.
No, sir. Hello?
Hold on, please. Hold on, please. Sorry, I'm having issues with my power. Okay, I'll fix it later on, okay? So your question.
This second This is interface passing /0/0, where you assign IP address 172.31.232.182. I think the subnet mask, I think it should be for class B.
Is it for this IP address?
For this, for the fast internet interface.
Okay.
That's an IP NAT inside. Yes.
Okay. It's for B, but they subnetted it. They said it's a subnet. Instead of 255.255.0.0.
Yes.
They actually submitted it. Yeah.
Okay.
So they borrowed another 8. So from here to here is the network ID, network not ID. Here. They submitted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is the way to configure your NAT dynamic. So there are some basic terms you need to know about. I think I must have said this thing before. What is inside local address, outside global network, inside global address, and outside local network address? Now, let me start talking about local, inside local address. I'm using here as my inside local. So it means that if I am here, in fact, this router will see everybody here as inside local. So this is my system now. We see this guy as inside local. This is my system now. Will see someone in the internet as outside local address. The same, this system will see this my public IP address as inside global. So I've explained what the outside global network is still almost like network of outside local addresses. So all these things you have to understand them. Inside local is still this is my colleague. I'm inside local. Here is my inside global. This guy is my outside local. The network there are outside global. This interface will see this interface as inside global. Do you understand? I actually try to give you a description, although these are the definition of what is inside inside global and all of that, but I just pointed out everything to you too, so that you have an idea of what is inside local, outside local. This is inside local. Opposite of it is far. Anything you can see from internet. And the same thing goes for outside global. But inside global is just your public IP address. So that is the terms you are meant to also get to know too. Then coming to PAT. Except you have any questions. Then coming to PAT, in PAT, there is always only one public IP address. That means this router now have access to internet with only one public IP address, unlike Dynamic that used to have up to multiple public IP addresses. But in PAT, you only have, most of the times you have one public IP address. It doesn't mean that you cannot have more than one. We'll talk about that later. So how does PAT work? It's still translation too. But in PAT, the way PAT translates is that, I don't know how to explain this right now. PAT we use the same. Okay, let me use this. Okay, I'll use this. For instance, a system sends message. This is the frame, the way it sent it. This is the system's IP address. This is destination IP address, for instance. This is this destination port. You so it's going to web service. Now, of course, you understand this one is a private port that the system spool to use. It's free and for local and private use. Now, when this thing gets, this frame gets to the router, router will change this IP address, the source IP address. It can change it to something like 51111, for instance, something like this.
Need to change the ports.
Yes, it will change the port. The translation is done on both the source IP. It will change the port and change also this one to public IP address. Maybe the public IP address is 1.1.1.1, for instance. It just translates the source IP address to the public IP address and also change this source port to another port number and send. Now, if another person wants to send message again, another system, same message, it will translate that person's, maybe that person is 1.6. It will still translate it to the same public IP address, but changes the port. You can give this one 51112. So any response coming to this port will belong to this IP address. Any response coming to this port will belong to this IP address. So in that case now, multiple systems can use one public IP address. One public IP address. Now, router will now be translating using the same public IP address with multiple ports. So you can, maybe when this guy is sent, that I'll translate it and give it port as maybe 51111. This one will now do, router will now translate it as 51112. So when this one is responding, the response to this port, router knows that it belongs to this guy. But if they don't respond to this one, router knows that it belongs to this guy. So in that case, they are using the same public IP address for different port numbers. You know that in NAT, if you exhaust the public IP address, this router will not translate for another person. Maybe now if I have only two public IP address, then this guy now came. Router now use one of it. This one now two. Router now use the other one. So this guy, other people have to wait until when public IP address is free, or when the session with that one is free, before they can now transfer. But in this case, in ports, we have so many ports that the router can actually use, can translate. So PAT is actually the default standard for all routers. All routers are on default as PAT. So most of the routers, you see that you only have the public IP address that ISP gives you. But whenever anybody, so many people can actually use it. By the fact that it uses PAT, it will not be translated using port numbers and all of that. As you can see here, source used this to destination. Okay, there was no explanation about that, but that's the explanation. The router will just be translating the port numbers. That's just what PAT is. Same public IP address, but different port numbers. I hope you understood what I just explained. If not, let me re-explain it.
Yes.
Hello? I hope you understood what I explained.
Yes, it's clear.
Okay. So, coming to, I've explained terms, then merits and demerits of NAT. When you are configuring NAT on your network, we have advantages. One is that public IP address is being shared and it is transparent to end users. It improves your security. So people will not know your local addresses. It can even make you to expand your LAN. You have one LAN, so many LANs, but two, they're using one public address and none of that. But for disadvantages, there are some applications that are not compatible with NAT. If you're using NAT, you have issues with some configurations of some applications. And it hinders legitimate remote access. Someone wants to access your network remotely. It can hinder that. And also it adds overhead load to your CPU. So your CPU is actually doing, CPU of your router is actually doing much more work than normal performance. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of NAT. And also, when you are routing, is it really important that you consider your NAT too, when you are routing? Because if, not just routing too, including your ACL too. With the knowledge of NAT, you still include your ACL to know where the transmission was made. If transmission was made somewhere, like let's say transmission was made here. There's a transmission here. So in my ACL, I seem to consider this. So that means if here is my outbound, I know that whatever thing that comes here will be translated to this. So I'll be working with outbound of this, at this place with this. I can't just say access list one, permit network. Maybe I'm permitting this network. No, you are permitting this because you know that as outbound, what is actually going out is going to be this, not this, because of the translation. So you need to be conscious of what actually goes around there. And also, you also include it in your routing too. Maybe I will talk about that one later on, but I didn't put the commands here. So that is now, for now, that is what we are meant to know under ACL. And under ACL and under NAT. NAT is network address translation. We have two types, static NAT and dynamic NAT. Static NAT is used most times when you have a particular IP address, for instance, a server that one needs to have access to from internet. So you configure your static NAT against such system or against such server. Of course, I showed us the configuration, how to configure it. But dynamic NAT is the one that you configure in such a way that you have access to multiple public IP addresses. Now, what after that, we'll not talk about PAT. PAT is port address translation. How do you configure PAT? The question is, how do you configure PAT? PAT is actually NAT overload. That's another name for it. Port-based network address storage is actually called NAT overload. That's another name for it. Now, if you're configuring PAT, the configuration is similar to NAT. But the difference is that in PAT, this is needed, But common sense will tell us that we don't need this. You understand? Common sense will tell us that, in part, you don't need this. Why? It's because external or your outside NAT is just Syria alone, and it has an IP address. So I don't really need to configure any pool. So here is where the second line, I will need this second line, IP NAT inside source list one. I don't need to have any pool now. I just say list one interface, the name of this interface, and I add overload. So it's this overload that makes it different from NAT. And also, for instance, if you have NAT already configured in your network or in the router, I want to convert it to PAT. The only thing you need to do is that just come to this line and add overload. That's after here, you say overload. That's all. Everything the same. If you use IP NAT inside source list one, pool, the pool name is just add overload. If you use IP NAT inside source list one, interface, Syria, whatever, you add overload. That's just the difference. You understand? Hello, I hope you understand. Hello?
Yes.
Okay. So that's just the configuration of NAT and PAT. The same configuration, just overload is the difference. Overload is just what makes it different. Like, this is my normal configuration of PAT, of NAT. If I want to convert everything now to PAT, I just come and add overload. That's all. Overload. I just add overload then. So that's what makes it PAT. That's port-based network address translation. So do you have any questions? If you don't have any question, I will pause it and continue into the next thing we need to talk about. So we are going to disconnect, we'll come back again. I'm disconnecting.